Our scene may have some nice lighting, but is lacking in some dimension with the swirls. To fix this, I can add some simple metallic materials, which I'll show you how to make in this lesson. If you haven't caught up with this course, you can check out the previous videos in the description below, or you can just follow along with your own project. I'm first going to change to this viewport shading here. This one is different from the final render view, so it can be helpful to change between this one here and this one here. This one here showing you how it'll look like in the final version, and this one just giving you a preview, which is a little bit faster on the computer. I'm first going to give my studio background a new material. So I'll left click it, and I'm going to left click this red and black checkered ball here to go into material properties. I'll also change my timeline here from timeline to shader editor. These two menus here are actually connected, and they're just different ways of representing the same menu. If I press plus new in here, for example, you can see a material appears here as well. I'm going to give this a name and just call it studio background. Also, if you ever want to delete a material but save it for later, make sure to press the shield button. If you're concerned, it's always safe just to press this button, as it will make it so it's never deleted when you close Blender. But as long as it's assigned to an object, you shouldn't have to worry about that. I'm going to change the roughness of my studio to 0.7. Roughness controls the reflectivity of an object's surface. If you want to learn more about shaders, I've got a full course on texturing and shaders. This one is free as well, and is also accompanied with free PDF guides, just like this course, and quizzes. Feel free to check that out in the top right hand corner and description below if you're interested. I'll press enter to make that roughness change. You can also change the color of your background if you like, but I found that a plain white background worked well for this animation. I'm first going to add my silver material. So I'll left click my swirl on the left here, and I'm going to press plus new in one of these menus. Some of you keen-eyed viewers may have noticed that when you change one of the values in this principal BSDF, it also changes it here. This here just shows the surface input, and you can see this BSDF is plugged into the surface, which is why. The most important setting for metal materials is to turn the metallic value to 1. You should only keep this value at either 0 for non-metals and 1 for metals. Roughness again will control the reflectivity. For example, if I was to turn this down to 0, you can see it's going to look pretty much like a mirror. And if I turn this up to 1, it's almost so rough that it pretty much looks like a non-metal. I'm going to keep it at roughness at 0.5 because we're going to use surface imperfections using colors in order to create some nice reflections. But just keep in mind, this is a great slider to create some easy reflections. There's a few other settings here which we're just going to leave alone. The only one I am going to change is this IOR value, which stands for index of refraction. Every material or object has an index of refraction, and silver's one is 0.18. I've actually got a free index of refraction PDF guide for different materials in the description below, if you want a guide which will show you the IOR for different materials. This is not a complete list, but will certainly help you with a lot of common materials, so feel free to check that out if you're interested. Changing the IOR isn't necessary, but it definitely adds an extra level of realism. Now we've finished the base of our silver, I'm going to left click my other swirl here to add a bronze material. I'll press plus new, and I'm going to call the material bronze. That reminds me that I actually didn't name the other material, so I'm going to left click my swirl again and call this one silver. I'll then left click back to my bronze one. First of all, bronze is a metal, so if you can remember, metals should have a metallic value of 1. This will create a plain metal again. I'll maybe turn the roughness down a little bit, but again, we'll add surface imperfections later, so this doesn't really matter. Then I'm going to set a base color of something a little bit more orange. You can see if I make it more yellow, we get a kind of gold color. But I found the contrast of orange and silver to be a lot nicer. That's why I went for a bronze material. This is an artistic choice, of course, though, so it's completely up to you. If you want to get the same exact color as me, you can left click this hex button here by when you left click on the base color, and you can type in the same number as me, and that will give you the exact same color I'm using. Now, for the IOR, you can think of it as the same as silver, but it has a 1 instead of a 0 at the start. So that means that the IOR of bronze is 1.18. Don't feel like you have to memorize IOR though. Rather, I just use a guide I made instead, or I research it online. Now, we can go ahead and add some surface imperfections. I'll start off with my silver here. I'm first going to need to add a few different nodes, and I'll explain what they do as we go. First, we're going to want to add a texture. So I'm going to add a Musgrave texture. If I plug my height into the surface here, it'll display what this texture looks like. You can see this texture creates a bunch of random splotches, which will make for a nice fingerprint-ish effect. This is important because all objects in the real world won't have a perfect shiny surface. Rather, they'll have fingerprints and things like that on it, and this can be a good way to represent that. Of course, you can also use textures downloaded from online as well. There, I'm going to press Shift-A, and under Input, I'm going to get my texture coordinate. You can see right now that there's a few cutoff points on this texture here, and that's because it's using the UV by default. But we want to use the object, which pretty much places the texture across the object evenly. Now you can see that looks a bit better. Of course, if you want it to be smaller again, you can just change the scale. Keep in mind though, if you press Ctrl+A and apply the scale, it will reset. So your two options are to always apply the scale, which is recommended, or you can just press Ctrl+Z to undo that, and you can just keep it at the scale it's at. But even if that happens, you can always just adjust the scale here, so it's not really the end of the world. I'm going to change the scale to something like 3. That looks a bit better. Now, an important thing to remember is this texture is black and white, and black and white values can represent represent these grey sockets here. Of course, the same would be for the yellow sockets, but with colour. Essentially though, a thing to remember is when using a texture in order to fuel a certain parameter on the shader, these green nodes are called shaders. Black will represent the number 0, and white will represent the number 1, and grey values will represent any number in between. So right now, as you might have guessed, the black areas will give the roughness a value of 0, which will be very reflective, and the brighter, whiter areas will create a more rough effect. If I plug my height into the roughness, and then BSDF into the surface, you can see this. Notice how those areas that were once black are more reflective, and there's rougher areas, or less reflective areas, in the white areas. But this is a little bit too high contrast, so I'm going to press Shift A, then under Converter, I'm going to choose Color Ramp. I'll then plug that in between here. You'll notice if I bring the black slider closer to the white slider, it will increase the contrast and sometimes even phase out the other color. But I want to keep it at the default and just make the contrast less. To do that, I would want to make the black one a little bit brighter and the white one a little bit darker. So I'll left click the black one and I'll maybe give it a roughness of this kind of dark gray. This will make it so it's still reflective, but it's not super reflective. Then I'll left click the white notch and I'm going to change the color to make this a bit darker as well, maybe to something around here. Now you can see this is a little bit less contrasty. If you want to keep extra organized, you can left click and drag to box select these nodes, press Ctrl J to join, and that will add them to a box and you can move this box around easy. Also, just like in the 3D viewport, you can press N to open the side menu in here, and under node there's a label option and you can give this a name. For example, I might call this roughness. Awesome. Then I might left click and drag to box select all these, press Ctrl C, and then I'm going to come to my bronze, Ctrl V to paste in here. And now you can see we have a roughness in our bronze now as well. I'll plug my color back into the roughness, and now we have some roughness on our bronze too. You can even make some variation if you like by just changing these values. Maybe I would make this a little bit brighter and this one a little bit darker, but this is completely up to you. If you want a more complex bronze material, I recently made a tutorial on this realistic bronze material, so you can feel free to follow that along and apply it to this object here if you like. That's what I used for my final render for showcasing the project in this course. If you want to preview how this will look like in the final render, you can just click this button here. Now you can see roughly what our final render will look like. Of course, you can also make some adjustments by moving the lights or tweaking the brightness, the contrast, and of course, tweaking the materials themselves. Well done on completing today's lesson. Now we're going to have a quick quiz to recap what we learned today. Number 1. What value should be only 0 or 1 on materials? Number 2. What setting did we change to add extra realism? Number 3. What texture coordinate option did I use to distribute the texture on the object evenly? Feel free to pause the video and take time to answer the questions. Then you can feel free to press play again and I'll answer the questions for you. Number 1. What value should only be 0 or 1 on materials? This was the metallic value. This is because there's no such thing as a half metallic material. So you'd only keep it at 0 for non-metals and 1 for metals. Today we made 2 metal materials, so both the silver and the bronze were set to 1. Of course though, because our studio background is non-metal, we kept the metallic value at 0. Number 2. What setting did we change to add extra realism? This was the IOR, or Index of Refraction parameter. This is a great way to add a little bit of extra realism, but it's more like a little bit of seasoning for your food. Number 3. What texture coordinate option did I use to distribute the texture on the object evenly? This was the object mode, and this allowed us to distribute our Musgrave texture, which is one of Blender's built-in mathematical textures, across our object evenly. Keep in mind that the object may not work as expected with image textures taken from your computer. Rather, it works best with Blender's built-in textures, such as the Musgrave texture. You may find issues when using it with the brick texture, as this acts a little bit similarly to a regular image texture. Great job on completing the quiz. Feel free to let me know what your answers were if you're not sure if you got them right or not. I'd be more than happy to answer them for you. Also, if you have any other questions from today's lesson, feel free to let me know in the comment section below. And as always with all the lessons in this course, there's a free PDF guide accompanied with it, which you can check out in the description below, which can be a great way to revise what you've learned or to help you in future projects. In the next lesson, we're going to be learning about rendering the animation in cycles, where we'll be covering different render settings and where to save our frames on the computer. Also, if you enjoy my teaching style, I also provide one-on-one coaching, complete with personalized lessons and post-lesson quiz questions and support. Link in the description if you're interested. Thank you for making it to the end of the video. You can also support the channel by making a one-time donation through Super, but even just liking, subscribing, and sharing if you enjoyed is more than enough to support the channel. Thank you again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.